right? I do thank you for your patience with some of the lengthiness of that series. There's just a whole lot of details in there. And from what it looked like that you were really soaking it in. That's good. And I don't want to ever give you just milk all the time. I want to give you meat that's going to strengthen you and help you to grow. But I hope that you've been enjoying the series. I really do. I try to make sure that I've got plenty of information for you so that you can so that you can kind of follow along and not get lost. Illustrations and things like that. But let's look at Colossians for tonight, all right? And I'm kind of rounding up the sheep as far as this message is concerned, because it's been a while since we've done this, all right? So I just want to look at the verse. The whole reason why we began this series tonight, and maybe one day we'll get out of chapter one. All right, so let's go ahead and look at, let's see here. All right, there we go. Verse 10, all right, Colossians chapter 1 and verse 10. That ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, unto all patience and longsuffering with joyfulness, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. And it's been a while since we've considered our worth at study. And, this is, like I said, this is our continued series on Colossians. I'm just kind of trying to round it up a little bit. But that is the verse. I think as Christians, the most dangerous thing that touches us as Christians is apathy. Apathy is, basically not caring. Complacency. It's a very dangerous thing for us. It doesn't seem like anyone else, it doesn't seem like anybody else cares. Why should I? I'm old. What can I do? I'll tell you, one of the people, I told Cindy. Cindy said she's not going to be able to make it. She said put it on YouTube. And I said Miss Cindy, I said, you're a pretty motivated lady. I said you'll benefit from this. But I said I don't think you're apathetic. So she's always so ready to get involved. She's ready to go door knocking. I'm like, Cindy, how are we going to get that to happen? But she wants to be a part of things. She's very energetic. And, she has every reason to, out of anybody in this church, to say, I can't do that. What good am I? That kind of an attitude, pastor doesn't seem interested. Why should I be? That kind of an attitude. What is apathy anyway? Well, the dictionary defines it like this, all right? Absence or suppression of passion. Emotion or excitement, lack of interest in or concern for things that others find moving or exciting. What a sobering definition. When it comes to reaching the world and showing people that our lives as Christian is worth it, the worst thing that we can be is apathetic based on that definition. It's a very sobering definition. And this is what I want you to grasp this evening. Some years ago, there was a movie made called Inception. I don't know if any of you have ever seen that particular movie. It was a very unique movie. I don't know if, I don't know if any of you have seen it, but like I said, it's really fascinating. The movie was about men who were able to extract information from people's minds by using a device that connected them to the person's subconscious, basically to visit their dreams. I don't know how true the whole thing is. You know, I know that there's, I know they're able to do stuff like that in the military and things. I don't know how, you know, it was a fictional type of a movie, but it was very interesting. And I gleaned a lot of it for a message like this. But, you know, basically, as far as extracting information from their subconscious, they were able to ask people in that person's dream, projections of that person's subconscious, basically people that this guy remembered and basically produced in his subconscious, they were able to go and ask them about things that they knew about this guy. Basically, they were getting information out of his own mind. It was really unusual. Questions that would give them the information. Thomas Cobb was given one of the most difficult assignments that he had ever been given as far as what he was supposed to do. This time it wasn't extraction. The mission was called Inception, all right? And the layout of Inception involved planting an idea in someone's mind that would change that person's outlook on things completely. Basically changed the whole paradigm of this person's life, his motivations, his ambitions, his desires. It all changed based on this simple idea. Cobb had what was called a totem, which is what you see him doing right there in the picture, which was a metal top that he would spin to make sure that he was awake and not asleep. It's really, you know, if the thing kept on spinning, he knew that he was, I'm getting somewhere with this, all right? But he knew that he was asleep if it kept spinning, if it never fell over. But if it fell over, then he knew that he was awake, all right? And I just want to encourage you today, let the Word of God be your totem. This is your totem, right here, the Word of God. The fact is, Satan loves to plant ideas into our mind, into our head, that completely alters our perception and ultimately leads us to destruction. He doesn't have to send fire to consume us. He doesn't have to do all of these terrible things to us to force us to beg for mercy or anything. He just plants a simple little idea here and a little idea there. He gives a little bit of poison here and a little bit of poison there. And then we destroy ourselves. That's basically what he does. Satan knows just how valuable a simple idea really is. But the Holy Spirit is also able to inspire you with a new idea on life as well. But he uses his word to do it. When the Holy Spirit plants an idea, inspires you with an idea in your mind, you always take the word of God. The Holy Spirit will never veer from what the Word of God says. There's a lot of ideas in the world. There's a lot of things that we're convinced of. But this is our totem to make sure that we're awake, all right? You can discern with your totem, your Bible, whether your perception of the world is false or if it's true. Isn't it interesting that James chapter 3 and verse 14 says, "But if ye have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth." If you have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, all right? You see, that bitter envying and strife is the result of one simple idea planted in your head by Satan. The truth is, you do love your enemies. In your spirit, who you are as a saint of God, you do love your enemies. You want to love your enemies in your spirit. You want to follow peace with all men. So don't lie against what's true. All right, the very next verse in James unmasks the unseen realm. Look at what it says. "This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish." I've shared with you before. If you ever study 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, you'll notice that it says, "I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." And basically, it's focusing on those things that are from above. The wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. All right, but in this particular case right here, you see that this wisdom descendeth not from above. It's earthly. All right, so now it's not spirit, soul, and body. It's body, soul, spirit. It affects us from the outside, and then it begins to affect us into the spirit realm, and then just really messes things up for us. Call Satan on that. Call him on it. That's not true. Use the totem of God's word. If what he's planted in your mind, if you think this just can't be right, find it in God's word. Seek counsel. Ask Pastor Mike. Ask Marianne. Say, look, I want to know, is there something in the Bible that says that I'm supposed to do this? Because I feel like I've got this idea rolling around in my head, and it just doesn't seem right, but I feel like it is right. See? Let somebody guide you. Let somebody help you. Use the totem of God's word, because the dream is your senses. All right? In reality, the world is the dream. This world is the dream. It's what God doesn't want you to be. All right? This is the reality, the word of God. If I can plant an idea in your mind tonight, and if you can understand that the genesis of that idea comes from the Word of God, if you will let that idea take you and work on you, fashion, perhaps even bend you, rather I should say it this way, let it change you. Because the fact is it will change you, but it's up to you. Jesus said in Luke 9:44, let, allow, give permission for these sayings to sink down into your ears. You see what I'm saying? That's faith. That's a key part to what makes your life a bestseller that people will want to put on their shelf. It's that part that makes people say, I want a life that's like that. You see, you remember the writer's triangle? All right, the writer's triangle is it's ethos, pathos, logos. Ethos would be the writer. All right, it's all about the writer. All right, that's what makes the story. Pathos is the audience. How are you going to address them? And then also how you're going to word it, the context. Make sure that what you're writing is going to make sense. All right, that little triangle right there is what makes an awesome story. It's been a while. And like I said, this is the format of a good author. God uses faith to help us look upward, all right? So if you look at our spiritual triangle, all right, spiritual writer's triangle, the way that God writes a bestseller, faith is how we look upward, all right? He uses our love to look outward, and he uses our hope to look forward. You know, we need to be able to look forward. These are the key ingredients. If you don't analyze, you may not realize that one of these is causing your apathy. All right, only you know if you're apathetic. Nobody can judge you or tell you anything like that. Only you can know. When you do that, the Bible says that you will be changed. If you open your heart and your mind and you allow His Word to sink in, you will be changed. 2 Corinthians 3:18 says, but we all with open face, there's the allowance for the idea. All right, let the idea be planted in your mind. All right, there's the allowance. All right, but we all with open face, all right, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, a mirror. All right, that's what a glass is. The glory of the Lord are changed. You know what happens when an idea is planted into your mind? It changes everything about you. You think about that. One little idea. I remember watching Ben-Hur, and I remember watching the scene where Masala is talking to Gaius, I think his name was. They were trading places as far as the office that he had there in Judah. And he goes, you ask how you fight an idea with another idea. That was kind of interesting, but he goes, how do you fight an idea, especially a new idea? And he's talking about Jesus. You see, at this particular time, they were hearing about Jesus and how he was doing these miracles, and this crazy man named John the Baptist who was out in the wilderness, you know, baptizing all these people. How do you fight an idea? That's what they were asking, right? Do you know why you, along with many other Christians, struggle with apathy? If you struggle with apathy, and you got to be honest with yourselves, if you want this message to help you, you have to be honest with yourself. And by the way, this is one of those things, I'm not expecting anybody to admit that they have apathy, but I just want you to analyze yourself, right? The reason why you and many others struggle with apathy, why I struggle with apathy, is that you need fresh faith. That's what you need, fresh faith. And I'm gonna explain that a little bit, all right? A fresh idea, something that will change every motive, every plan, every ambition, something that will change your entire life. A little idea, all right? You see, what appears to be apathy at church is actually a sign that another idea is eating away at your spiritual health, kind of like a parasite. It's kind of like a parasite, all right? It eats away at you, and you don't even realize that you have it. I remember there was a guy that was a missionary, and he was in some kind of a tropical island somewhere, and Jonathan Barber was telling me the story. The guy had some kind of a parasite, and they could look in their tent with the light with the lantern light on. And they could actually see the parasites moving inside of their hand. It was just eating them alive. They had to get off the field and they had to move to a different climate. That's how you kill a parasite sometimes. Sometimes you just have to relocate altogether. You know, another way that you kill a parasite is by changing your eating habits, all right? But these other ideas are like a parasite. Satan, when he shoots fiery darts into your mind, right? The Bible says that we may be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. What is it that we use to quench the fiery darts? The shield of what?
Faith.
The shield of faith. All right, because what happens is those fiery darts are ideas, and they consume us. They hit us. And we don't realize that they hit us, but Satan is a master at planting ideas into our mind. And a lot of times those ideas are going to destroy us. Just a little bitty seed will destroy us over time if we don't stop and analyze and check ourselves and make sure what's wrong with me, all right? You're motivated by something. All of us are motivated by something. It's just that sometimes, maybe, even you don't realize what it is. And if you're not sure, much of the time it's probably not good. But that's why Psalm 119:105 says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. The word of God, that's what plants our faith, all right? That's what gives us that idea that helps us to be able to keep moving forward. It changes our perspective on everything. When you turn, you know, I don't know if I've ever told you this story, but when I was a janitor, I used to work in my old third grade hall. I used to clean the hall that I was in third grade in. It was really interesting. But my boss told me one night, he said, hey, Mike, he said, there's nothing in the hallway. We were cleaning. There was nothing in the hallway. He said, I'm going to turn the lights off, and I want you to try to run as fast as you can down the hallway. And he turned the light off, and when I started running, I just felt like I was going to trip over something or run into something. I could feel it getting ready to hit me, but it wasn't there. But then when he turned the lights on, I was like, there's nothing there. But he just turned the lights off. I just saw that there was nothing there, but in the dark, I still felt like there was something in the way. But when he turned the light on, it changed the whole perspective on things. Changed my whole mind about things. And that's what we need to let the Word of God do. Those foul ideas that Satan puts into our minds will eat us away. It will leave you sluggish, and it will leave you unfeeling. You know, a lot of times we go about feeling ill, sluggish, and it's because we have a virus or some kind of a bug, but we don't know it. You ever been there? All right. I don't know why I'm so tired. And you go to the doctor and you find out something, and you're like, so that's what it is. All right. I'll give you an example. When I had COVID, for some reason, at around 12 midnight every night, I was a live wire. I felt like I had to get down and start breakdancing or something. I could not figure out what was wrong with me. I thought, Marianne, is this COVID? Because every night at 12 o'clock, I'm like, I've got to jump or do jumping jacks or run around the house or something. But for some reason, I get this burst of energy, and then I'm awake till about 3 o'clock, and then I go to bed and I sleep all day. And I'm like, Marianne, I got to fix this. I could not figure out what was wrong. My wife, she is great. She's like a doc. She could be a doctor or a nurse practitioner or something. She pulls out her phone, just like in a matter of seconds, she goes, you need to stop drinking Gatorade. I was like, Gatorade? She goes, yeah. She said, it's got electrolytes in it. She said, it's making you a firecracker. And so I put the Gatorades away. She got me a whole case of them because I needed to make sure I hydrated myself while I had COVID. Boy, I had a real bout with that thing. But when I put it away, I was able to sleep all night. I found out what the problem was. But I didn't know exactly what was wrong before. And it's the same thing with us, right? So, you know, we're talking about apathy today. All right, remember what I said the definition was? All right, look up here again. All right, the absence or suppression of passion, emotion, or excitement, lack of interest in or concern for things that others find moving or exciting. All right, you know, you need to get your totem out. Get that totem out. What did I say that your totem was? The Word of God. All right. The first thing for you to do is to admit to God. This is the first thing you do. With apathy, you have to be honest with yourself. The first thing you have to do is admit to Him, Lord, I'm not excited. I don't find myself motivated. I can't seem to get excited about what you want me to do. Wait a minute, Pastor. Is this one of those messages where you're trying to get us to get more involved in the church? Yeah, it is. But remember what I said. Let me plant an idea in your mind that you know comes from the Word of God. All right? And then I said, understand that the genesis of that idea, all right, understand in your mind, that wasn't Pastor Mike's message, that came from God's Word. You see, when I tell you, don't think of giraffes, what do you think of?
Giraffes.
Right, you think of giraffes, all right? But you can trace that idea to me, because that's something that I said. This is not Pastor Mike said so message. This is a thus saith the word of God type of a message. So that's the first thing that you have to understand, right? Does the Bible tell us to be devoted? Yes. Yes, it does. What is a lukewarm Christian? Meh. I might go to church. I might not. I might go soul winning. I might do this. All right, that's a lukewarm Christian. A lukewarm Christian is somebody, you know, isn't it great to be alive and praise the Lord? And the lukewarm Christian goes, yeah, that's great, yeah. You know, I would say lukewarm is probably the same thing as apathy. I'm going to ask you this question. How many of you want to be lukewarm Christians? Nobody. Nobody wants to be a lukewarm Christian, all right? Now answer this one in your head, all right? If you're dishonest, you're just lying to yourself, all right? I don't know, I don't want to know, I don't need to know. But I just asked you how many of you want to be lukewarm Christians. Now, don't answer this out loud. How many of you are lukewarm? All right, now just answer that honestly in your head. How many of you are apathetic? Are you apathetic? All right, that's the question I want to ask. The definition of apathy on the screen, again, you see it right up there, all right? Are you that? Is that who you are? You take a look, all right? Is there an absence or a suppression of passion, emotion, or excitement? Is there a lack of interest in or concern for things that others find moving or exciting? Is that you? The Bible tells us to rejoice always. Do you? And here's another question. Is saying, well, you don't either, Pastor. Is that going to help you? Because the fact is, there are times where I struggle with it too. But is it going to help you even if your pastor doesn't? No, it's not, all right? Do you want to be better? Do you want to be excited? Do you want to not only have hope, but a lively hope? That's important. Go to God and tell Him, this is what I want, but I know I don't have it. That is the first step. Does the Bible tell us to witness? All right? How many of you would like to say that you witness to somebody at least once a day by either giving them a tract, inviting them to church, or just telling them the gospel? How many of you would like to be able to say you do that? Like to be able to say you do that? All right, now, don't raise your hand and just think this, all right? How many of you actually do it? All right? The Bible says that we need to. Our hearts tell us that we need to. Why? Because the Word of God is written in our hearts. We don't need anyone to say, hey, witnessing is good, inviting people to church is good, giving people gospel tracts is good. We don't need that. It's the church age. We have the Holy Spirit to convict us already. You already know, but here's what you need to do. You need to tell God. You need to say, God, this is me. This is who I am. I know I'm not. I don't find myself motivated. I don't find myself caring. I don't find myself getting excited about the things you're excited about. I want to be in love with you, God, and I'm not. Honesty is key. Honesty is key with God, because the fact of the matter is, you know you're apathetic. You know you're apathetic if you are. Getting a little bit tongue-tied here. If you're apathetic, you know it for sure, all right? You know you struggle with caring. I'm going to just tell you something. Calvinism is one of the worst man-made parasites to cure the complacent Christian. It is a man-made formula to ease the conscience of complacent people. That's what Calvinism is. It makes them hateful, and it makes them mean, all right? And they don't even realize that they are. Well, what's Calvinism, Pastor? All right, here's what it is, right? It's the belief that God has chosen a certain elect. All right, basically, we don't need to send out missionaries. We don't have to go soul winning. God's already picked out those that need to be saved. I don't have to do it. God already knows who's going to get saved. Yeah, you better believe He knows who's going to get saved. He knows who's going to go to hell because He didn't tell them about it. That's the reason why He knows. But here's the thing. Calvinism is a way to salve somebody's conscience, but in fact, the Holy Spirit inside is saying, you need to get out there and tell your neighbor about Jesus. You need to tell that friend of yours the gospel. You need to at least give them the, give them that website, the Pandemic 323. You need to give them a tract. You need to invite them to church. Something. You may not know the gospel. Bring them. That's our vision this year. But all the while, the Holy Spirit is doing that, and their hearts are condemning them. All the while their idea is Calvinism. You see what I'm trying to get at here? Their idea is, well, God's already chosen His elect. I don't need to go out and witness. But then the Holy Spirit inside is eating you alive, saying, you got to get out there and give out gospel tracts. But you keep cleaving to, no wonder it makes people so hateful. No wonder it makes people so depressed, all right? It's ideas, it's thoughts, all right? It makes them bitter, envious, hateful. Does what you believe match up with Scripture? You see, there's not just the sin of commission, all right? That's sins that you commit. But there's also sins of omission, all right? Things that we leave out in our life. Not loving our spouse, that's a sin of omission. Not giving the gospel out. Not forgiving people. not being merciful, not giving to someone who is in need, not getting more involved in your church. That's the sin of omission, all right? So much more ought to be, so much the more ought we to be active in our church at a day when Jesus is about to come back. Because the world is so full of self. We're in the last days. Does it bother you that our works will be tried by fire? Does it bother you? Or are you like, you know, I really just don't care? I mean, look, I have found myself at times to be like this. There have been times where I've thought, I just don't care about the judgment, you know. It ought to bother us. And if it doesn't bother you, you've got to go to the Lord and say, what's wrong? What's wrong with me, Lord? You made me. Help me. Does it bother you that souls are going to hell? Does it bother you that you never once told your neighbor about Jesus? If it doesn't bother you, there's a parasite that's eating you. If you are apathetic and you know it and you see that it's a problem, then you need to go to God and say, Lord, something is wrong. I want you to understand that your first step from apathy is to acknowledge that you are apathetic. Going to the Lord, saying, I'm apathetic. Now turn with me in closing to Psalm 139, all right? This message took kind of a little different turn today. But I want you to look at this really quick, all right? This is just such a comforting verse, and I just want to just show you how that it's, the way that it's worded, it's just so, it's so wonderful. I have not yet planted the simple idea in your mind yet, but I'm cultivating your mind right now so that I can plant a little idea in your mind that's going to help you with your walk, all right? If you're struggling with apathy, if there's any, if you're feeling like, you know, I just heard a message on the rapture, and really, I have no motivation to get out there, all right? Look at what it says, all right? If you're in the habit of marking in your Bible, I want you to underline, thou hast searched me and known me. All right? That's the first, O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Well, what does he know? Look what it says. Thou knowest my downsitting and mine uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off. That means that he knows your understanding before you even started understanding it. Or your thinking, before you started thinking it. Thou compassest my path and my lying down, and art acquainted, you know, these are all the things that he knows. He knows, he's acquainted with all my ways, everything that I do in the dark, in the day, at night, and behind closed doors. He knows all of these things. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it all together. Thou hast beset me behind and before and laid thy hand upon me. Such knowledge, you see this? Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain unto it. That's an important verse. I would encourage you to underline that verse, all right? He's saying the knowledge, the way that you know me, is a knowledge that I can't even acquire myself, all right? Verse 7, whither shall I go from thy spirit, or whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me, meaning you can't get away from God. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, even the night shall be light about me. Yea, the darkness hideth not from thee, but the night shineth as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to thee. You know, we think that we can hide. We think that when it comes to hiding from God, it's just like a little kid who thinks that a blanket can hide him. It's just like a kid who takes a blanket, covers himself up, and thinks that his daddy can't see him. That's the way that we are when it comes to hiding from God and what we think is darkness, it's light to him. Look at 13. For thou hast possessed my reins, thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. You don't know when you were born. You can't remember what it was like when you were born, but he does. Verse 15, my substance was not hid from thee when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Do you know what I think that verse means? I think that verse means that he knew all of the elements floating around in the water and in the dirt that would eventually make us up, the nutrients that our mother would eat. He knew everything that would make up our body. That is absolutely incredible. All right, look what it says, verse 16. Thine eyes did see my substance, yet being imperfect, and in thy book all my members are written, which are continuance or fashion, when as yet there was none of them. How precious also are thy thoughts unto me, O God. How great is the sum of them. If I should count them, they are more in number than the sand. When I awake, I am still with thee. Look, I pointed out to you last Sunday that one cup like this, full of sea sand, full of shore, or sand on the beach, is 15 million grains of sand. All right, now, I told you that that was just a simile. All right, they were like the sands which are on the sea. That's not what this passage says. This passage says that his thoughts toward me are more than the sands that are by the seashore. Mm-hmm. That's amazing. All right, so look what it says, verse 19. Surely thou wilt say, do you think about yourself that much? I mean, I think about myself a lot. I can be pretty egocentric. But I don't know if I think about myself that much. You know, we process about 60,000 thoughts a day subconsciously. It's quite a lot. That's not how much he processes. He processes a whole lot more. You don't need to worry about yourself. He's really thinking about you, all right? Verse 19, surely thou wilt say, slay the wicked, O God, depart from me, therefore, you bloody men, for they speak against thee wickedly, and thine enemies take thy name in vain. Do not I hate them, O Lord, that hate thee, and am not I grieved with those that rise up against thee? I hate them with a perfect hatred. I count them with mine enemies. Now look at verse 23, all right? Search me, O God, and know my heart. Now, look back at verse 1 again. Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. This whole chapter is all about how well God knows you. You can't hide from him. And the fact of the matter is you're talking to a God who knows exactly what's wrong. And so the simple idea that I want to plant in your mind tonight is that God knows you better than even you know yourself. And you need to study that passage right there. Just look at it. Let it soak in. Think about what it's saying. And go to God and say, Lord, it says, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me. And know my thoughts. Know my thoughts and see if there be any wicked way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. Do you know what David's saying? David's saying, Lord, what's wrong? Something's wrong. I have dis-ease. I'm not happy. I feel depressed. I feel tired all the time. I can't get motivated. I can't get excited about church. What's wrong, God? Lord, is there any sin in my life? Is there anything that I'm believing that's not true? Can you guide me in the Word of God? Can you show me, is there anything, any sin, any practices? You know, a lot of times, if you really begin to analyze, the Lord will show you, well, it's because you're doing this, and he'll point out a sin that you're struggling with. And I'm going to tell you something right now. When the Bible says that sin brings forth death, it really does. Sin is poisonous, and it will affect your health. And the fact is we get into such bad habits sometimes that we don't even realize that our diet, we don't realize our intake. Do you remember what you ate 5 days ago? I don't. I can remember maybe some of it. But the thing is that we can't remember those types of things. And so we don't realize what we're putting into our spiritual system that's making us sick. And we need to ask God, Lord, is there something I'm eating? Is there something that I'm doing that's making me apathetic? That's making me making me complacent, lukewarm? Lord, please show me. You've searched me and known me before. You know me better than I know myself. You think about me more than the sands that are by the sea. Lord, please search me. Help me to see if there's something that's killing me. Because I want to be alive again. I want to have hope that helps me to look forward. See if there be any wicked way in me, Lord. I'm going to be honest with you. I don't know. Take care of what you do know first. But then ask God, say, Lord, something's wrong. Help me, Lord. That's the idea I want to plant in your mind. I encourage you to pray that way. If you are down, if you are struggling, if you can't seem to get any life in you, you know that verse that says, they shall mount up with wings, or they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. There's been many times where I've been like, Lord, I tell you, that sure does sound good. I don't feel like my strength's renewed, though. The fact is there might be something that's wearing on you, that's making you ill. Let God help you and make sure that you use your totem, all right? Lord, thank you so much for this time we can be together.
I just want to take a moment to say thank you so much for watching this broadcast. If you have any questions about the message or would like to chat in any way, we would love to connect with you. You can message us on Messenger and we will get you in touch with the right people. I also want to invite you to place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ personally, to make Jesus your own personal Savior. Friend, if this message has helped you understand the gospel, that you cannot earn your way to heaven, that there is no way to achieve your salvation, if you've understood today that salvation is a gift from God, and all you can do is receive it by faith, then why don't you act on the promise of God? Why don't you claim the truth that Jesus Christ himself said that whosoever would believe on him should not perish, but have everlasting life? Wherever you may be right now, I hope that you will bow your head and heart before God and place your faith in Jesus Christ. Tell him that you want him to be your personal Savior. He will come into your life, he'll be a Savior, a Father, and a faithful friend, and he'll change you beginning today. To find out more about this decision, I encourage you to message us or go to the link below me, bit.ly/pandemic323, to learn more. And I want to thank you again so much for taking part in this broadcast, and I hope to see you next time.